137 shots. A man drives his companion down a Cleveland street, and before he knows it, police sirens bite into the night air, sending a chill down his spine. He pushes his foot down on the accelerator, trying to avoid this madness. Little does he know that within minutes, he and his companion will be shown their last vision in life, 137 shots fired into them, courtesy Cleveland police. This happened in 2012. On Saturday, a judge there acquitted a cop involved in that shooting for leaping atop the car's hood and emptying his semi-automatic 15 shots into the bullet-ridden bodies of the two occupants of the car. 137 shots into a car of unarmed people said to be sparked by a car's backfire. Legal, justifiable. The two had traces of drugs in their system, the judge noted. They were thus expendable. 137 shots. It's okay, no biggie. Boys will be boys, right? The law is naught but opinion, whether a judge's or anyone else for that matter. In the season of Ferguson, when youth are in the streets yelling Black Lives Matter, we learn that this is more aspiration than reality. It is a bitter hope in the cold kingdom of the law. For today, black lives don't matter a bit. From In Prison Nation, this is Mumia Abu-Jamal. These commentaries are recorded by Noel Hanrahan of Prison Radio.
The views and opinions in that of the arena does not reflect that of Comcast, his staff, or members, or even new members. With that being said, viewer discretion is advised, and the views of Black Sun does not reflect that of the arena. We are a council. All right. It's been a long time coming. Mm-hmm. I've been waiting on Hamid.
Get some introductions in.
Yeah, let me get the introductions okay. To my right. Thank right. you, Yangus.
No
that's
problem,
why I got
brother.
A council.
No problem.
Keep the dictator in line. Okay. To right.
Hi guys, this is Ava. Happy to be here again.
Again. Yeah. Okay. Well, I'm Hamid Awad. Well, I'm happy to be here too. So you can ask the question you want to ask.
Right on.
Right on.
Yeah. I'm Dawn. I'm happy to be here.
I need somebody to wake up on that switcher, please.
Well, I'm Dawn.
There oh, okay.
Oh, jeez.
Hi, I'm Dawn, local activist.
All right, what's up, man? It's Yanga. Glad to be back. We'll get it together. It's just, you know,
yes,
we'll definitely be with the people. But glad to be back, man, and looking forward to an interesting show and having the brother Hamid on, Dawn and Ava and everybody. So, you know, we can get right to it. Did you give him a advisory warning about White Son? Because I know I can see White Son about to come out on this show in a couple times. White Son
knows about White Son. He works for a long time. Here's me on the same page. How you doing there? All right. I mean, he's good. I mean, we've been trying to have you on the show forever here.
Yeah.
In a day, you know.
You talk about Sunday. Sometime, you know, Sunday, all the time you spend with your kids.
Yeah.
Okay.
And yeah. I will gotta come in last week Sunday, but you know.
Well, we glad to have you on here, man, because the topic is super serious about with the bombings that's going on in Yemen, with the propaganda what's going on. You know, apparently they're trying to get, allegedly, from what they say, the propaganda, they're trying to get the terrorists out of Yemen, and you know, and this feeds into this whole anti-Islam phobia, this whole anti-Islamic thing, this Islam phobia that's going on. But to start it off, why don't you give us a little bit of what's happening in Yemen? Why are they bombing? Why is Saudi Arabia, with the backing of the United States, bombing Yemen?
Okay, well, thanks for having me.
You're welcome.
That's the first thing. Saudi Arabia now, I think they have their chance just only now. They try us for years. You know, many years they tried, like from the 50s. You know, they used to be a you know kingdom, but in Yemen in the 60s they fight. You know, they get you know the freedom. So from king, so we become a president. So after that, so from then they don't like They want to be controlled. They want to control Yemen, period. They know what we have. They want to just try to take over.
What is it that you have?
The land, mm-hmm. and the, you know, the oil. They know before we know. And they have the oil before we even know. Mm-hmm. Mm. So they know. They still have some of our land still there. Mm. Yeah, some like a, something even Abha. They call it Abha Yemenia. It's Abha. It's some in Yemen, mm. Yemen land. When you go to the geographic and all, you can see Yemen is go all the way to in Saudi Arabia. Mm-hmm. So every time they see a president, like, you know, try to do some for his country, like they try to do some for Yemen, mm-hmm. they will try to do anything. Anything they will try to kill him or to whatever they can do, they put their hands in. Mm. And they did it before, you know, one president in the 70s. Mm-hmm. There was Ibrahim al-Hamdi, they called. Mm-hmm. I was kids, I think, by 7 years when he got killed.
Mm. Wow.
Mm-hmm. And Saudi Arabia have the hands of it. Because they want to unite, they want to, because they're two Yemen, you know, they'd be South and North Yemen. Mm-hmm. And they will try to be united in then. Mm-hmm. So they don't want us to come become to one country, like mm-hmm. the United. They don't want us to be like that.
So are you guys united now, or still at North and South Yemen?
No, we united in 93. Mm-hmm. So they, you know, in 87, there was a fight in South Yemen. It's a lot of people get killed, you know, mm-hmm. and that's supposed to be then, they're supposed to be united then in 87, you know, but it didn't happen. So this president come in Ali Abdullah Saleh, when he was, mm-hmm. he'd been there for a long time, he'd been there for 30 years. Mm-hmm. When I say he was better, but he did a lot for the country. He took a lot of, you know, mm-hmm. he eats some too much money, whatever he mm-hmm. get from the country, because we have a lot of oil. Yemen have a lot of oil.
Yemen is rich in oil.
Mm-hmm. Rich in oil, yeah.
So that's what the whole thing is about. Saudi wants the Yemeni oil.
Saudi, okay. United States came to the... to Yemen, I think they have hand like 20 years ago, and they have a contract. Mm-hmm. And they the ones start drilling the oil in Yemen. Mm. Sheikh Zayed bin Sultan, he was in UAE,
mm-hmm. United Arab Emirates.
Yeah.
Emirates, that's right.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, he helped us then. When he come to root, he's from Yemen. That's mm-hmm. one. They have mm-hmm. called it Sid Marib. He built a lot of things in Yemen. So he started helping us. But what those, the United States and German and some Middle East country, they come, it's another country coming. They tried, you know, drill mm-hmm. the oil.
Turkey?
No, not Turkey.
No, it was okay.
But the number one, it was United States when they right. come to drill. That's when United States come in to drill in Saudi Arabia, they don't want. Mm. They don't want them to drill. They don't want.
Saudi Arabia didn't want the United States to drill.
They want that's us to be a poor. They want Yemen to stay a poor country.
Saudi Arabia did.
Yes.
Why would they want Yemen to be a poor? Yeah, so they could. So you'd be subjugated, still be up under their rule, or something.
Yeah. They want us to, you know, because it's a lot of Yemenis working in Saudi Arabia. Mm-hmm. You know, millions.
Okay.
Of them.
Okay.
It's a
Yemen and Saudi Arabia border each
yes.
other. Right?
We, you know, we travel. And we, you know, we
so
drive.
So it's very close.
Very close.
So they get all the help, so all the good labor comes from Yemen.
Yes, from Yemen.
Wow.
Y'all serve the coldest lemonade and everything.
Yeah, okay. Say something like that. You can't call it that, right. But it's not that.
It's not that. That's what they're trying to make into.
That's what they tried to make it.
I have a question, Hamid. So, like, they didn't want the United States to drill. So wouldn't that cause a conflict between Saudi and the United States?
Mm. And they're friends anyway. They are allies. Yeah. You know, they have, I think it's the first countries in Middle East have their base.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
They have the largest base in Saudi Arabia.
In Saudi Arabia?
In Saudi Arabia, yes.
In according to the religion of Islam, that...
they cannot. They
yeah, the Prophet Muhammad they, Islam said that they shouldn't they be... Cannot. Non-Muslims should be in Saudi.
But they did. Mm-hmm. Now, every time, that's what I was just saying, every time somebody tried to do good for the country, mm-hmm. they don't want that. The world was against it. They will pay somebody to hurt you. That's how they did. Now, the King Abdullah, he just died.
Yeah.
That's right.
He just did. Mm-hmm. And he loved Yemen. Yemen loved him the same thing. He was a nice king. He mm-hmm. was one of them. So he did. This guy come up.
the crown prince. What was the crown prince's name?
Salman.
Salman?
His brother, okay. Salman, yeah. So he take over. So he's the one nobody like anyway. It doesn't matter. So to us, barely. When I grew up, I never liked Saudi Arabia, period. Not the people, but the king, you know, the kingdom.
The government,
You know, the government. It's not even government. It's just only one person control all, you know. If you go to immigration, you see everybody only from the king or son or...
Everybody related.
Everybody related from, you know, Al Saud.
That's right.
That's it. All Al Saud. Mm-hmm. They control all the country.
That's why it's called Saudi Arabia.
They were called Saudi. Right. No, but they because they're not even their last name, but they call it their last name.
Yeah.
They were not there like 1,000 years ago. They were not there, you know, Al Saud.
Right.
No, nobody. There was like Yemen. Yemen, you know, is 23 million, 24 million people. Mm-hmm. They tried to take over.
Mm. But is Saudi Arabia doing anything that the United States or any other country hasn't done? Like, oil right now is plentiful, so it's more cost-effective to go take somebody's oil than to run around looking for oil, digging holes.
Good point.
Well, I know you got something to say about that. You mentioned earlier about, you said Saudi Arabia was running out. Why do Saudi Arabia want Yemen's oil?
Oh, because... They almost run out of oil. Mm-hmm.
What? Saudi's almost out of oil?
Of course, they run out.
Wow, I never thought you don't know that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's why I was shocked when I heard that.
You see, they be produce oil for how many years?
Yeah.
50.
United States have a lot of oil, eh?
Yes.
But they get it for cheaper from there, so they didn't have to drill. They didn't have to pay nobody to... This is soil here.
Yeah, well, you keep saving ours for reserves.
For the time.
So when everybody else runs out, we still be able to drive our Humvees.
But Yemen have a lot. Even the state I was telling you, Hadramaut. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Even like 3 weeks ago, I was talking to my brother on the phone. Mm-hmm. And this guy, the president, Abdul Bouhadi, whatever he was, he went to Saudi Arabia. And they ask him, they want to make a deal. They can give him Hadramaut. They say, you want Hadramaut, one of the big state, one of the largest state in Yemen, big state. Rich in fuel, and most of them people, excuse me, in Saudi Arabia, they're from Hadramaut, rich, like Bashan or all them rich, rich people, controlled construction, they're from Hadramaut. There's a lot of fuel in it, a lot of oil in the ground, in the soil. There's a lot of oil north in Saudi Yemen.
Okay.
But you see, if Saudi Arabia, if they were doing the right things then to help us to drill, and they can take even the 50%.
They want it all. What's 50% when we can have it all?
Yeah. All of it.
That's true.
Yeah.
But they can have nothing now.
Right.
But if they try then and help the country grow.
So you think that Yemen is strong enough to keep Saudi from invading and coming in and taking their oil?
Of course.
And their military. I want to ask two questions. First of all, is the UAE down with the United Arab Emirates? Are they supporting what Saudi is doing?
Yeah.
Because I heard they were supporting them a couple other places.
10 countries.
Right.
In Saudi Arabia is the headquarters.
Okay.
They know they have backup. Because you know why they back up? Because United States.
Yes.
Yeah.
Of course.
This country, I love this country. We all see U.S. citizens from, you know, but... I will fight for this country, not against my country.
Right.
I will fight another country, not against
absolutely.
My country.
Right, absolutely.
For this country, I will, you know, I will give my last in a drop of blood.
Yeah.
But if they come to ask me to fight my country, I'm not going to do that.
Right.
You understandable.
Know? So, United States back up Saudi Arabia, United Arab Emirates, Qatar, Kuwait, Morocco.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's 10 countries.
Yeah.
You know, 10 countries.
Mm-hmm.
Egypt.
Yeah. So the 10 countries, I guess what? One country.
Mm-hmm.
For what? Nothing. We have nothing in there. They want to fight who? Rebel?
Right.
But you know what I find odd, Hamid, is that on one hand, you have them demonizing the
Houthi.
The Houthi rebels. They're saying because that they don't want weapons supplied from Iran. But then on one hand, but then on the other hand, they're supplying Iran to fight against ISIS.
Okay.
So it's like, okay, so I don't see the how you're dealing on one hand, say, well, no, don't support Yemen, but yeah, we're going to support, you know, and on the same side as Iran and in Syria also. You know, they want to support the rebels, but they don't want to support the rebels in
okay,
Yemen.
That's fine. That's how, oh, yeah. No, let me just, no, no, I'm going to take it off anyway. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to do it. Okay, like you said, they, Iran, they say they back up Houthi, they back up.
Yes.
So if you know where, why so why didn't stop them?
Good point.
Mm-hmm. Why didn't good stop point. Why didn't go to stop them? Okay, if the military just, they can, they have only one way they can go. Air or water.
Right.
Like they did in the 93 when, you know, when Saddam and all that.
When they invaded Iraq.
Yeah, yes, Iraq. Yeah. Because they want to come to Yemen, Yemen say, no, y'all cannot come to our part.
Oh, also, yeah, talk about that too. I remember one of the, in America, Yemen didn't want to vote on the whole situation, and they said that would be the worst mistake that Yemen ever made. You ever hear that?
No, I don't believe. You know what? The worst, the, you know, let me tell you what the worst Saudi Arabia did now when they went to Yemen. That's the worst thing they ever do to Middle East.
Agreed. Mm.
And so maybe the whole Middle East, maybe half the world, because it's what do you call it? The ship. You know, Savannah, what do you call it? Savannah.
The docks.
Yeah.
Yemen have the largest docks. The Yemen control, you know, the Red Sea.
Yeah.
Yemen have almost have the Red Sea.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. You cannot go through only to Yemen or Egypt.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Cannot to Suez, or you can come from Bab al-Mandeb from Yemen or Aden. That's all the thing. That's why they try to fight. That's why all them see. United Arab Emirates, they want to buy the dock in Savannah. You know that a couple of years back. You hear about it?
Yeah.
But they say no.
Mm-hmm.
United States say no, we're not going to sell it to Arabs.
Right, no.
That's how they said.
Yeah.
So now they think, okay, only have our chance only in Yemen.
Mm-hmm.
They try to control Yemen just like, you know, United States control everything. You know, control Saudi Arabia, control Iraq, control Libya, control all that.
Yeah.
And they want to control us. That's not going to happen.
What happened to President Abdullah Saleh?
Ali, that's what I was just talking about. Yeah. He's okay. Ali Abdullah Saleh now he fight back now.
Mm-hmm.
He resigned in what 2011, 2012 he resigned. So they voted the Abdurrahman Mansour Hadi for the president. They voted him. You know he was when they started when they bombed the mosque that Friday.
Mm-hmm.
It was, I think it was monthly.
They bombed the mosque?
Yeah.
During Yom al-Jumu'ah?
Yom al-Jumu'ah. When the president, all the government in it.
Wow.
Wow.
From the president.
Mm-hmm. And hold on, and for the non-Muslim, Friday is the religious, is the day of a prayer for the Muslims, or the day of gathering, called the day of gathering, Yom al-Jumu'ah. So to bomb it at that time when they were at worship is a travesty
crime.
In itself.
Yeah,
it's a crime in itself.
It's a crime.
So, but I was explaining that for our viewers.
Yeah, yeah, and that's fine, yeah. Because when they bombed that mosque, whole government in there. Mm. A lot of people died. Mm. One of the president, you know, the president, he was the president then.
Mm-hmm.
When they tried to change, they want to just change. They call for changes.
Mm-hmm.
We agree for changes. It's okay. You can leave.
Mm-hmm.
We can agree. And he agreed to leave.
Right.
Well, you know, but to fight and they kill people and they bomb mosque, they bomb innocent people for no reason, that's not acceptable.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. They vote him in, they can vote him out.
Right,
absolutely.
Right.
You know, in Yemen, then you can go with $1 million in your pocket. Mm-hmm. Nobody got to say nothing to you. I'm telling you.
No robbery or nothing.
No robbery.
You're not exaggerating how many.
I promise you not. Wallahi, I'm seriously.
Okay, I believe.
I'm telling the truth.
Yeah.
Now, you can even walk with $100 in your pocket.
Wow. Is it better? That bad?
Yeah. That's what that bad is in 5-6 years. Before that, you can go. People, you know, they never even use bank. They keep their money in the house and all that.
Mm.
So after this president came in, the new president came in, it changed the whole social culture and climate of Yemen to where it's got that bad. What has made it get there? And you're talking about voting in. We already know that certain countries, if they don't agree with the leadership you vote in, we see it with in Palestine with Hamas.
That's right.
When the people have voted Hamas into the leadership, mm-hmm. and America and its allies said that it was, since it was a terrorist organization, it wouldn't recognize Venezuela. It wouldn't recognize them, and they only recognize Mahmoud Abbas.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And is he still with the PLO? Is that the backing of his party? Yeah, they only recognize Mahmoud Abbas. Mm-hmm. So we see the same thing happening here when the people voted out this president, that the countries around America, Saudi Arabia, they wouldn't accept the people voting them out or something. What's going on? When do the rebels come into play? How did that all come about?
The Houthi rebels come after. Yeah. They fight the rebel, the Houthi rebel. They fight them for 5 years, five times, 6 years. They fight them inside. They can't get them out. The government, we're not gonna say they get weak and they just back off.
Okay.
With the Houthi rebel. Okay.
Right.
So the people come in 2011. They come. They try to, you know, they change. What they say? When they start with? They start with Tunis. I think Tunisia. They started first. Tunisia. They want to change. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
And yeah, everybody start come after.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So okay, so we want to change. That's fine. We can change. So, but after the bomb and all that, that's, you know, after the bomb, he was in Saudi Arabia, the old president Ali Abdullah Saleh.
Mm-hmm.
So when he come back, he said okay. So, Kuwait, Saudi Arabia, all the Gulf countries, they come together. Then they write a piece of paper, you know, agreement.
Mm-hmm.
So he just changed from, you know, he changed the presidency. So he just. He said, okay, I resign. And he, you know, they can vote. He was here, actually. He was in the United States when he was in medication. He was up here. When they vote for the other one president.
Mm-hmm.
And he talked on TV, okay, they can vote him. Everybody went and vote,
mm-hmm.
but for 2 years. See what he got to do
mm-hmm.
for the country. Mm-hmm. With all that killing and, you know,
right.
before everything, you know, bombing houses and stealing and go bank and rob people and all that.
So let me get this straight. I mean, so you're saying that Saudi Arabia invaded Yemen first, right? I want to make sure we get this straight.
Yes,
this time around, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, so now, because I'm trying to figure out how the media is demonizing the Houthi rebels, if that is the home, Yemen is the home of the Houthis, so how are they... You understand what I'm saying? How are they violating and you have occupiers?
I think
occupiers.
One of the things that they did is, if I'm understanding, if I'm following it correctly, that after Abdullah Saleh, the first president, mm-hmm. left, that the system had got so bad, and the second president, what's his name again?
Abdul Mansur Hadi. Hadi.
The second president,
yeah.
what the brother said, after the second president came in, that they voted him in for only 2 years because the country was in disarray.
Right.
So they voted him in to see what he was going to do. He didn't live up to the promises. So they're trying to remove him. But at his removal, I think that he petitioned Saudi. He went, did he initiate the whole invasion saying, I want my presidency back? And these rebels came in. Is that what was happening?
But no. But you see, his time was 2 years. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
But he stayed one more year. They went exchange.
Oh, they gave him a whole another year. His time was 2 years. They gave him an extra year.
And he was trying to just take over. We don't want. That's why.
Trying to turn it from the people's power into a dictatorship.
Okay.
Oh yeah.
So that's what the people, they say, no, we don't want that.
So that's when the rebels.
That's when the rebel Houthi come in.
Yeah. Absolutely.
That's what
okay,
they
so the Houthis are justified.
Yeah. Right. They say, we fight all these years. We want to change. We want to change. Mm. Anyone that just take over? That one just take 30 years.
Right.
Okay, so we're saying the disrespect of sovereignty here.
Yeah, it just leaves. You know what? It's a lot of people, very intelligent guys in Yemen.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of millionaires in Yemen.
Mm-hmm.
Even from here to Yemen to anywhere you want to go.
Mm-hmm.
It's a lot of, you have another guy who can take over.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Barack Obama, like, 13 years, nobody want. Everybody know Barack Obama.
Yeah,
right.
When I see him speech, you know, when we carry speech, and then that speech make you cry. You know, in 6 years later, that man was a president.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
That's right.
It's a lot of people just very intelligent, just like that.
Yeah.
When, while we're talking about how the media demonizes Yemen, One thing that I've been doing is keeping up with the drone strikes from the United States. And since 2015 began, there have been consistent drone strikes on Yemen. I mean, practically, I would say maybe an average of two a month. In January 26th, there was a 13-year-old boy, I'm probably pronouncing his name wrong, Mohammed Tuaiman. He was 13 years old. One media source described it as, you know, the United States bombed, you know, suspected Al-Qaeda. Because most of what I see in the media has been like, we're trying to get Al-Qaeda, but and we're hitting all these militants. Of course, what they do not do is they do not name the militants. So there's no real confirmation. But the Guardian actually interviewed Mohammed. And when he interviewed Mohammed, Mohammed's 13 years old. He had lost his father and his brother to a 2011 drone strike. So they were murdered by drone strikes. Yeah. And so he was, you know, he was given a camera by the Guardian to, you know, sort of like, you know, this is his life in Yemen and stuff like that. And then months later, January 26th, he was killed in a drone strike.
That's right.
United States drone strike.
Him and his cousin.
His cousin and a Saudi man. You know, and so I saw two different stories.
That's right.
In one story, they were saying yes, Al Qaeda militants were killed and da 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 da. But then over here, there's a story about that they said a teenager, but they didn't say it was a 13-year-old boy. You know, I think about what Obama has with a kill list. I think about. You know, now what my sister was talking about, the oil and everything.
Don't forget the Endless War Act.
And so I think about how it's even represented in the media. You know, the vague information. There's no confirmation of who these people are, but we've confirmed that they are, you know, Al-Qaeda militants. But this 13-year-old boy was like, hey, man, you know, they call the drones the death machine.
Right.
So that was their experience, the death machines. They would see, you know, the machines. And so when he died, so that means the drones took three members of the family away. And one of the 13-year-old surviving brothers was like, you know, my brother was not with Al-Qaeda. You know, he's 13 years old. We'll go to court to prove it, but we're going to support Al-Qaeda now, you know. So when I'm thinking about how it's demonized in the media, you know, it almost seems like, you know, a 1984 thing. We're at war with ISIS this week. We're at war with, you know, Al-Qaeda the next week. You know, it seems. But then what I didn't know was that Yemen had a whole lot of oil.
Yeah.
And so so what is your opinion, you know, living here in this country and seeing, you know, I bet you did you know that there were drone strikes in Yemen since 2014 too, but I know that they don't really, you know, it doesn't trend on Facebook. It's not, you know, on the front page. You know, they just kind of slip it in there.
But I talk to my brothers, and I have brothers, you know, dad, they have family. My brother is in military. I was in the military when I was 14 years old.
What?
14?
Yeah.
Wow. Did you volunteer?
No.
Or he's come get you, throw you in the military?
No, like, not really, because my daddy was in the army.
Okay.
So, and my older brother, but he said, I'm not with it. So he finished and walked away. But the third brother, the older one now, he's still. He just came, that was just Dr. Kenny, he just came from Saudi Arabia 10 days ago. Because, you know, they wait and wait and wait. Okay. 3 weeks ago, a tractor trailer coming loaded with food, you know, and rice and all that. They struck.
They hit the tractor
trailer. They blow it up. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
So they can see the street, you know, I mean, the highway, major highway, full with, you know, food and all. And one other chicken, whole trailer full of the chicken. Same thing.
Yeah, they don't want to feed the people.
But now they say by mistake, and they end up saying the Houthis, you know, the rebel.
Yeah,
did
the Houthis.
Oh, of course
they
would.
They blame this.
Right, right.
A warehouse, cookies, I mean, not warehouse, is a factory. Factory. They know it's factory. They know it's factory for years.
They're bombing. They did the same thing in the Sudan. I mean, they have a history.
And they say, the Houthi shit. They say it in the Houthi shit. You know, the Houthi rebel did it.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the Houthi rebel. You did it.
Yeah.
They did it every day. Now, if I call my brother and talk to him right now, mm-hmm. he can make you hear they bombing every day in the city of Sana'a.
Mm. Sana'a is the capital, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
They never go to the other side, the north water. Mm. They, you know, if you know the guy, he's there. So what the hell are you doing under that mountain, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Because they have, you know, they think they have missile in there.
Mm-hmm.
They want to burn it. They cannot burn the mountain.
So why do you think Yemen got such a bad reputation? Why did they get a bad rep? And why isn't there more world support for, you know, the atrocities that's taking place in Yemen?
One thing, we're poor people. We not say we're rich people.
Mm-hmm.
But we are good poor people, but we cross, mm-hmm. you know, to the community. Sometimes you got to go to the limit.
Okay. Yeah. And Yemen's are, yeah, so the Yemenis are Arabs, not Persians, right?
No, we're Arabs. We're Muslim, Arabs, right. Arab, Muslim, right. We have no...
And y'all poor people, so y'all like, well, y'all like the black folks of the Arab world or something?
No, we're not saying no.
Okay.
What do you mean?
I mean, they're picking on y'all. I'm trying to figure out why they're trying to pick
on y'all. You know, they're picking at us because they say now they're picking up for Al-Qaeda and all that for years. They started from, it made them from the 90s or before that they started hitting in Yemen. They didn't like Yemen, period.
Yeah, I mean,
they say
just,
that there's
a
major Al-Qaeda site in Yemen.
Yeah, and they go, most of them, they in Afghanistan. And the other country, where they, you know, where they are, the Al-Qaeda, they're real.
Mm-hmm.
And now they make them in Yemen, so they say, okay, now is our chance just to move in Yemen. And they move out because when they come with the money, like me and you, poor, if you come with dollars, where the dollar come from?
Hey, get down with who got the money?
Who got the money now? You know, because it's a lot of poor people.
Yeah.
Don't get me wrong. It's a lot of, you know. Hey, if I'm there, I will do the same thing.
Yeah.
Going back to what Yanga and Don were saying, the media has a way of, they're owned by corporations.
Yes.
So the media has a way of making it seem like it's a terroristic war when it's really economic wars.
Mm,
and that and wars generate money.
Yeah.
Regardless.
Yeah. Now it's war between countries. It's not against, now it's just Yemen, one Yemen now.
You're saying they're just picking on Yemen because Yemen's poor? Well, I got to play devil's advocate. So Yemen hasn't done anything. Yemen hasn't housed so-called terrorists. Yemen hasn't housed anything. In fact, I hear Yemen is very strong as far as religion is concerned. The Yemeni people really display have a devout faith in the religion of Islam. And so could this be a reason that a lot of so-called terrorists are hiding or using Yemen as a base? You're just telling me that America got it wrong, the Saudi got it wrong, everybody got it wrong, they're just picking on Yemen?
No, I'm not saying they have no terrorists. No, they do have terrorists.
There's terrorists here.
Yeah, right. They do, but no, it's public health. There's a lot of population in there, and tourists. Mm-hmm. For years, they, you know, because they try to fight them then, and they back up the other side.
Okay.
When you try to, you know, to fight too many animals around you, sometimes you have to back up a little bit, you know, to.
Mm-hmm.
They know they have a lot of Al-Qaeda over there. They know it's a lot of, but they're not even, the problem, they're not even Yemenis. That's the problem is.
Okay.
They're from all over.
They're using Yemen as a hub.
They they're mostly from Saudi Arabia. Okay. Most of them.
They come from, Because I hear that, you know, we were talking earlier about the oil, the United States, we like us some oil. You know, we invaded, you know, a lot of countries for that. We like some oil. And so I think about, you know, just kind of like, you know, Yemen is the place of terrorism. I think about how undereducated a lot of, you know, Americans are in this country about the Middle East besides, you know, our allies in Saudi Arabia. So I'm thinking, you know, geographically, you know, Yemen is right underneath Saudi Arabia, right?
Yeah.
Wait.
Yeah, close. No, it's...
Yeah.
See, that's
yeah. Okay. Close enough.
Yeah.
But it's just like, you know, they have the United States is their ally. And, you know, and something that I have seen in like UN videos and stuff like that, a lot of people don't want to say boo to the United States. So I'm wondering just.
What do you mean by boo?
They don't challenge the United States. I meant like boo. Like, that's what I meant.
I don't think the Yemen don't care. You know,
no, no, I mean within the UN.
UN, because they have the weakest people in the UN.
Yeah, they do.
Right. Let me cut you off. But if they have the right person to speak for your people, they think about it a million times.
What would be the right person?
The one have intelligent, the one go to school, the one learn, the one have...
The ones that saying, we need to bomb the Israelis back into
to,
the sea.
We didn't have to, you know, to go in and kill innocent people. The one is not that violent.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes you pour somebody in and just for the cheer.
We're going to make Hamid the spokesman.
It sounds like you have a lot of wonderful people in Yemen. There's more than enough people who can speak.
It's a lot of, what do you mean? It's Yemen is a big country. It's 24 million people. Yemen
is
a big.
But see what's going on here. Let me explain some good old-fashioned American politics to y'all. So every time we send a leader over into an Arab country, you know, we train them out of here in America's Georgia.
We do.
And then we make sure that they make deals with Saudi Arabia, our puppet. And if they go against our deal and the people rise up, we got to take them out. Fight power.
Yeah.
I mean, that's...
That's true.
Right. Look at Syria. Look at Yemen. Look at what other...
Just look at Iraq first.
They call them the economic hitman.
Yeah.
Right.
Oh.
When they go in.
That's what...
You either going to play ball with them or we going to start a war.
Mm-hmm.
We got to get the money somehow. We got to get... Mm-hmm. We got to generate income.
That's what Saudi Arabia do to all them countries, you know. Even Qatar. Qatar started coming in like 6-7 years ago, you know, Qatar.
And you know they're not going to attack Saudi Arabia because we got the Kaaba, so you know.
That will attack them, of course.
Wait a minute, how are you going to attack the Kaaba?
They're not going to touch it. Kaaba, you know.
See, they know that.
You know what?
What is the Kaaba?
The Kaaba,
I'm sorry.
You know, the holy... Okay. Lil Kaaba, Rabbin Yahmiha. You know what does that mean? لِلْكَعْبَ رَبٌّ يَحْمِيهَا. You say, it looks like a, you know, the mosque.
الْكَعْبَ
رَبْ.
Yeah, رَبْ, Lord.
God.
Yeah, look, God.
Protected.
Yeah, God protect, the mosque is protected by the Lord.
That's how they call it. But in Arab words, in Muslim language or Arab language, they call it لِلْكَعْبَ رَبٌّ يَحْمِيهَا. Like this box right there. Nobody got to come to touch it. Even if they go inside, they will never touch the mosque. They will never touch Al Masjid Al Haram, whatever. Mm-hmm. They will never touch anything, you know, to religion. They know what they're going to. They know what they're looking for.
Basically, he's saying they're going after the people. They're not going to destroy this land. But what Son is saying, that with their position coming off as the custodians of the, as them being labeled the custodians of the holy sites, would that hinder people from, or would that act as a cry to the Islamic world to come to our rescue?
That's,
you know what I'm saying? Because they're calling themselves the custodians.
Right.
That's the only thing they think they will save them.
Yeah.
Mm.
But you cannot save them when they kill a lot of innocent kids in Yemen.
And when they're killing Muslims.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For no reason. You have no reason to be there.
But that's why they will later with them, either ISIS or, you know, Al-Qaeda or the Taliban. They get these names and say, oh, yeah, well, they're evil. You know what I'm saying? Even getting...
Say ISIS but they're is not worse telling than Al-Qaeda.
They're not telling what they're doing over there.
No.
Where are they, though? You see, you go fight them. You know where they are. So why are you killing the innocent people in another state? Mm.
So are they over there, though? Are they over there?
They say they're there, but where? They try to, you know what? If they can help to get them out, people from inside, they will help them. They will take them.
So anybody showing, so basically it's an excuse. Anybody showing a devotion to Islam is labeled a terrorist.
Wow.
That's off the rip. And so they're using that as an excuse to go in there and invade for the
that's
oil.
That's what they just, you know what, let them try the missiles they have, the plane they got. Mm. Let them try whatever they can get. Let them try whatever they have.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
the country will take.
I mean, they got a new weapon out. I call them the flying guillotines, where there's a barrel and there's blades in the barrel, and so when the barrel explodes, it goes in the direction of the football field and cuts everything up.
Mm.
And every country has banned the weapon except for the United States and Saudi Arabia.
Shock.
You heard about that weapon?
I heard about it, but...
But it's not going to...
Trend.
Right, it's not going to scare them out.
It's not going to work.
Huh? Right, but I mean, yeah, but this weapon is treacherous.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
People...
I'm sorry, you ain't heard about it, dog.
Didn't I come say that on the news?
You know, usually I do hear about that.
Yeah, you talking about on time? Yeah, Democracy Now, yeah. Yeah, in fact, it makes a noise. It's when the barrel sits, it's so terrifying, it goes... So that's the warning that people know that
they only got
so many seconds. And when he stops and then just blades just shoot out everywhere. They outlawed that weapon. Yeah, they said it's so barbaric and treacherous. They were like, so every country's like, ban it.
Yeah.
And United States is like, well, you know.
Well, the United States is a democracy. We need horrible weapons.
Yeah. We're not a democracy. We're a corporatocracy.
Corporatocracy.
That's good.
Right. They have two mountains. They have two mountains in Yemen. Mm. One of the mountains they hit like almost 10,000 times.
Mm.
Oh, it's not a mountain no more.
But it's still standing. They can't touch big mountain. Excuse me.
Okay.
When you say the mountain, it may be like five, 6 miles. You know, big mountain.
All right.
They try to bomb them. Two of them. They bombed the one across from it.
Mm-hmm.
It's between the city is Sana'a is between. That mountain and that mountain.
Mm-hmm.
And they have some armies, missiles. They have a lot of weapon in it.
Yeah.
When they bomb it, my brother sent me a picture in it. You can just see everything flying in the night in the air. Flashing, everything is.
Like lasers.
Yeah. You see, people live there. They never run. They stay.
Yeah.
My uncle, I called my uncle. I say, "What happened? Why you didn't go home?" He said, "I'm not going. I'm not leaving my house. I'm staying."
Yeah.
The people in Saudi Arabia, and the border from Yemen, they leave their houses, town. They move out.
Mm-hmm. So, what do you think that? When do you think it will stop? When they get the new president in, or when they get a pipeline, or what do you think will stop the massacre and the bombings?
Well, first of all, the people are too smart to go for the okie doke by some puppet president. Let me tell you that right now.
Right, but it's not about going for the okie doke. I mean, I'm hearing now the resolve of the Yemeni people that they would never. I mean, you can know somebody's a puppet, but after they keep bombing, you like put the damn puppet in to stop the bombing. But you're saying Yemeni people's resolve is that they will
fight back.
Continue to fight back. Well, what's their end game? What is Saudi looking for? What are the Yemeni people asking?
They didn't even start fighting. Yemeni, they didn't even start fighting back.
So they're just in defense mode. They're just defending
themselves.
They're
just waiting.
Waiting.
You know what? The Ali Abdullah Saleh, the president of the day, I think all the army, they just wait for one word. If that guy just go on TV or just speak, let's go. We go. Trust me, they in Saudi Arabia next day.
Do you think he's waiting on?
You know what? He fights sometimes. He fights Al-Qaeda. That's where he fights Al-Qaeda in the north.
Mm.
He the army, most of them, they all over the country.
Okay.
They try to fight them, push them away. Mm. Kill what they can kill, or just at least they let them go for a minute, so they can go back here.
Okay.
They start like 3-4 days ago.
Okay. So a lot of hit-and-run tactics.
They just hit-and-run tactics.
Okay.
When those guys, 7,000 people, military, when they go to Saudi Arabia, in Saudi Arabia and Yemen, the border, they have the army, more in Yemen army, just only in the border. So they think we cannot go through.
Yeah.
Protected border. Mm. Sounds familiar.
Three weeks ago, I tell you about that. 3 weeks ago, people go inside Saudi Arabia, give them a message. They did what they did, leave them a message. They tell them, see, look, we're from Yemen.
Yeah, we can get to you.
We can get to you.
Touch you.
Right.
Oh, yeah, we can
they
touch
did.
You.
Right.
And they back off.
Oh, man. Now, okay. Yeah. So.
So they, trust me, they not started yet. But when the military started, trust me, they're walking.
Yeah.
They'd be walking. You think they got to be walking.
Yeah.
What do you think as... someone who's been here for a very long time, and personal question: do you consider yourself an American as well as a Yemeni? Or okay, so there are some people who come here to this country and they expect a lot of good things from this country, but your new home has also been a place that has been bombing your old home. What kind of feelings do you have about that? I mean, you know, even to the point to where the corporate media is even reporting, you know, sort of like all these civilians are, you know, getting killed, and they're not even reporting that accurately. What? How does that make you feel living here in this country?
You know, if I have, I think if I'm a single person, if I don't have any kids, I walk back home. I didn't have to swim. I didn't have to fly. I walk.
Mm. Wow. Mm.
Yeah.
Because you're not against this country. This country have given me the opportunity more than my own country gave me. Don't get me wrong, no? I love this country to death. It doesn't matter what, how much.
God bless America.
Yeah, and God bless Yemen too.
Yeah,
that's right.
Yes!
And the country I grew up in and born, I love the soil. I love the soil too. You know, home, you know, you got no car.
Right.
You work hard. Right. But you still live.
Yeah.
You have no cell phone, but you still live. Yeah.
So you're thankful for the opportunities.
Yeah.
I appreciate it, and I love the opportunity I have,
here. But yeah, there's no place like home.
No.
You know?
Nothing like
that. That's good. That's good to hear you say that. You know, there's nothing worse than someone forgets where they come from.
No, of course. I will never forget. That's what I'm just saying. This country gave me, and I live in this country more than I live in my own.
Yeah. Right, right.
Yeah.
But as you're living in this country, you know, they say that you have the right to appeal to your government. They say you have the right to challenge your government. So your government right now, your government as in the United States, you know, your government is, you know, declaring war essentially. Well, not actually declaring war. That's kind of, that's the kind of sneaky thing they do. You know, steadily bombing your home and steadily, you know, demonizing the people who live there to steal the resources.
Wait a minute, Don, it ain't us, it's Saudi Arabia. We're trying to get Muslim terrorists. Go ahead, I'm sorry.
So, yeah, that's what they said with Iraq. Anyway, they say that every week, you know, like I've been hearing that okie doke since high school. Sort of
and,
like,
it's their fault that it can. I blame George Bush Jr. I mean, it's their fault. When they removed, and this is not to digress, one thing I will say about George Bush Sr., he knew when to draw the line. His thing was, we're going to run Iraq out of Kuwait our allies, but we're not going to remove Saddam Hussein.
Right.
Because we don't want to destabilize the region. I'm not no big supporter of Saddam Hussein, but you did not have Islamic extremists come up when Saddam was in power, because Saddam was taking heads.
Yeah,
you hear what I'm saying? He didn't even let him have that type of freedom of expression. And when George Bush Jr. came in and removed Saddam from power, it destabilized the region.
Caused the void.
You know what I mean? It caused a very big void. And then you had all of these damn groups so-called popping up because of that void that Saddam, if I'm not mistaken, Saddam was what, a socialist? Communist or something? The Ba'ath Party is communist. I mean, Saddam wasn't he wasn't Islamic.
No, he wasn't Islamic.
He
was a dictator.
No.
Saddam was
of course he was a Muslim. He was Islamic.
He may have been. I'm not going to question his dean. I question his
leader. You know what?
Yeah. Because the Ba'athists are like socialists, like mug, you know.
Yeah, that's true. But
I thought the Ba'athists were like atheists. They didn't. They're Islamic. Okay.
But do you know what he did for his country?
He probably did. Saddam did a lot of good things for his country.
He's not like Gaddafi.
He's not like what?
Gaddafi?
Gaddafi. I think I don't have a problem with Gaddafi.
Different things about Gaddafi.
Gaddafi is the worst.
Really? Oh. Man, we got to have you back on the show.
Oh, we got to come back on here.
No, I'm not coming back. I will.
All right.
But, you know, Gaddafi have a lot of money. He helped other people in the country, in the region. He never helped the people in his country.
He never helped out the people in his country?
When he started something, you know, even in Yemen, he did something in Yemen, but he never finished. He goes somewhere, Liberia, he never finished.
But a lot of people in Gaddafi's country was raised. I think they had a problem with Gaddafi because Gaddafi was claiming some of his African heritage.
No.
Like, you look at when they got Gaddafi, some of those Arabs were the worst people that treated Gaddafi the worst. When they got Gaddafi. Gaddafi didn't live in his mansion. Gaddafi lived in a tent. Gaddafi was talking about the United States of Africa. He was talking about getting an African banking system and unifying Africa. I think those Arabs had a problem with Gaddafi.
No. His own people have problems.
Which are mainly comprised of what?
Okay, you know what?
Arabs.
Yeah, that's true. But if you have all that money in the oil, why you have people poor? And he's Libya, a rich country, man.
Yeah.
He live in the castle, gold, and all that crap. You know.
I already lived in a tent.
castle.
He had a castle, but he lived in a tent.
Yeah, well, he lived in a tent after he died. but you know, poor people. You know, if you want to do that, make sure the people back you up inside.
Yeah.
Your own people.
Yeah. Yeah. So it wasn't a racist thing with Gaddafi. It wasn't the Arabs had a problem with him claiming his African heritage.
Arabs, you know, they were scared of Saddam Hussein. Old Arab, that was scared of Saddam Hussein.
Yeah.
Because he's the one make them, you know, and he's the one strong in the Middle East then.
Yeah.
That's Uday and Hussein, man.
Yeah, no, but Saddam, he was, you know, the first one, it was Nasser in Egypt.
Yeah.
One of his good students.
Mm-hmm.
He learned, you know, and he go back, take the country over from another guy who was trying, you know.
Yeah.
That's how he can become a president.
Yeah.
And he set the rules and regulations.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Well. When you go to Iraq, Iraq clean just like a whistle. You go in the street, it's nice.
Yeah,
he built it.
He held it down. They say you have to be firm with you Arabs.
Yeah, that's why they were scared. Now that's why they're scared. Even Egypt, they were scared.
Yeah.
That's how they let the United States and all them country come through Canada, Swiss when they was in.
But Saddam had relations with America during the war when exactly.
Right.
So I mean, he was. I don't know. I'm gonna have to look at the Islamic thing. You know what I'm saying? There's a little bit of questioning on that. I think that he had relations with America. I think that the dog came home to bite him.
You know what? Hold up. When it comes to religion with them, the high class people. I'm not saying high class. When it comes to the president or
They're gonna practice it a little different.
You will never know what they do.
Yeah. Yeah.
What we know, what people tell us, what the media say.
Yeah.
Right.
But we don't know nothing about.
But I'm looking at the alleged human rights violations against the Kurds and things of that nature. According to the media, this could just be propaganda. What one of the reasons, the justification for going to get him, and not to get off the point. I think my whole point was, regardless of what he was doing over there, because I don't think you can tell a person, you know, people know their people better than anyone.
Yeah.
We didn't see. The destabilization. We didn't see what we see now when Saddam Hussein was in power. You know what I'm saying? We didn't see all of these so-called terrorist groups popping up and all this, you know, all this madness and havoc being, you know, going on in the Middle East when Saddam was in power. I think when George W. Bush Jr. went in and removed him from that seat of power, it created a void. It created a vacuum, and you have all of these so-called extremists and everything trying to fill this vacuum.
I would also point out that a lot of these operatives have been trained by the United States.
Man, so many of them. Osama, this so-called
right down.
Osama bin Laden was a client of the CIA.
Absolutely, to give Russia.
But the problem, they know what Osama from the beginning.
Yeah.
They know where he come from, where he are, where he live.
Yeah. But they got to have an enemy. They got to justify going into these other countries.
Because somebody else's name.
Yeah, because
they use somebody else's name.
See, and they destroy communism, so it has to be the Muslims now.
Yes.
You know, so after the Muslims, I'm telling you, world, look out, who's going to be the next enemy?
First they came for the Muslims.
First they came for the communists. Then they came for the Muslims.
The Muslims.
Who's going to be the next him? The way it's going, look like the black man is quickly rising up on that target. If we get a country, they're really going to be, you know.
Black people are never off the list.
Yeah, we never. Yeah. We ain't going to be able to come up and get
it's a permanent list.
Right.
But this is not. It's nothing about, you know. But my point is, where we came from, like Saudi Arabia, the point is, they have no. If their president, he want to be a president. They don't want you to be a president. So why, you know what? He went to Saudi Arabia, he want to be a president. They want, if I promise you, if you come back, you might not leave one day.
Ooh.
Ooh.
Dang.
I'm telling you.
Yes.
It's just like a trader. Right. To me, he's a trader.
Yeah.
Wow.
Is that the sentiment of the Yemeni people that the people
that's
feel?
I'm one of them. He's just a trader to, you know.
To
ask another country to help you to be a president?
That's right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, you can't do that. How do you do that?
Well, actually, you resign. A lot of countries do that.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I'm just saying, but you're back. Okay. You resign. Let's give somebody a chance. If they want to vote you in, if they vote you in, that's fine.
Exactly.
Put your name in the list. And they vote you, that's hey.
Exactly.
You
that's too much like right, though, Hamid. That's that's too much like the right thing to do.
Yeah, but he tried to take it over with power. They're not going
to
vote him in.
Yeah, they're not going
to. To run
Go ahead, Queen. To run for president in your country, you need like back from the corporations, or who funds these elections?
They use their own funds.
Okay. It's they use their own money?
Yeah, but it's sometimes, you know.
Do you have to be a Yemeni national to be, because I can't go over there and run for, I can't be like vote for Yanga. I mean, I'll be a great president.
I know you will.
Man, inshallah ta'ala, man, I'll be a good president. Vote for me, you know, to the ass.
You may be better than Abdul Rabu Mansour.
Hey, I know I'm better than Abdul Mansour. I know you. Know. Yeah.
But that's my, you know, the point is you have no reason to go.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to just go and live, that's fine. You go ahead. Nobody will follow you.
Yeah.
But if you know, just go to make this guy mad, or make this guy mad, or you want to just, you know, hit somebody and tell them, I have power. You don't have no power because you use somebody else's power.
Yeah.
You need.
Yeah.
And then against your own people. Your own
that'll
blood.
Never work. Mm. So he wants to go. He really wants to come in under the disguise of a democracy, like you voted, being in like president. But he really talking about dictator.
Yeah,
he really wants to be a dictator.
It's not gonna happen. This they gotta be a civil war now.
Yeah,
that's right.
So is that the only thing that will stop it? Is him coming into power? What will stop? What will stop these drone strikes? What will stop the senseless murder of men, women, and children in Yemeni? And what can we do in our last few seconds?
Yeah.
What can we do? Is there somebody we can write? Is there a Yemeni support group? How can we, as American citizens who are against the drone strikes and the senseless murders of men, women, and children, and what's happening in Yemen, how can we get aboard with this this outcry? How can we, you know,
and close this out?
Speak a
minute. How can we voice our support?
Yeah, how can we voice
our support? We can't do it. Only people in Yemen can do it. You know why? They have to go in Saudi Arabia. They have to fight back.
Well, we're going to start over here, the Americans for Yemen.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yes. They can, you know what, us, we have nothing we can do. We can talk and, you know, go demonstrate.
We can show.
We can show, but we cannot do it. Only Yemen, you got to be all Yemenis, you know. Yemenis from Shia or Muslim, we all the same brother.
Mm-hmm.
Yemen, they got to go all together, all Yemenis.
Mm-hmm.
No more Shia'i, no more Sunni, no more.
Allah in the Quran doesn't say Sunni or Shia anyway.
We're all Muslim. Yeah. That's what they need to go back, one Yemen.
Yeah.
Okay.
And do what they got to do.
If they y'all stop set tripping in Yemen. Stop all that Shia and Sunni stuff, man.
So if they want to go back in Saudi Arabia, that's the only way for them. They have to hit them for them to stop.
Could we speak to our government about foreign policy, though? I mean.
Secretary of State.
That's right. All right, y'all, we've wind down to the last couple of minutes. Next we're going to be back in June. So we're going to have a surprise topic. So we out with the arena. Peace.
Deuces. See y'all next week.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Man, thanks for coming.
Thanks for coming.
I'll come back again.
It was hard.